Hello, welcome to another episode of Python for LEGO Spike Prime. Today we're going to learn how to use Python to make a robot follow a line. Hello, my name is Gary, and today we are going to build driving base 3. Okay, so if you haven't been following our lessons, we've been using driving base 2 previously, and if anything doesn't make sense during this lesson, then make sure you check out the older videos here just so that you can be up to speed with where we're at. Today we're going to be following a line, like I said, and line following is one of those activities that really separate someone who's really experienced with robotics and someone who's just starting out with robotics, because line following takes a lot of trial and error and also a little bit of a strong understanding of what robots are capable of and how sensors work. So like I said, we're going to build driving base 3 first. So to build driving base 3, go into build. And then you scroll down to driving base 3. If you've got driving base 2 built, then driving base 3 is just an addition of the color sensor. So if you build your color sensor on top of driving base 2, it can still work. Okay. So here is driving base 3. So build the driving base, put in your sensor module. Okay. Once you've finished driving base 3, let's have a look at our robot and try to understand a little bit more about how line following works. So if you have a white surface, this is going to work best, okay? But if you don't have a white surface, then anything that's really light colored will be ideal. Here I have a bit of black paper to represent a black line. It's going to work best for you if you have black duct tape, okay? So if you duct tape a line on your surface, that's going to be the best way to test your robot for now. Okay, so how does the line following work in theory? Well, if you have a color sensor in front of your robot, what it's meant to do is if it detects a black line under it, then it tries to steer away from the black and until it sees that it's not black anymore. If it sees that it's not black anymore, then we steer back towards it. Okay, so in actual fact, this robot is going to try and find the edge of the black, of the blackness of your black line and the whiteness of the surface. It's actually not going to travel on the black line. It's going to find the edge of the black line and travel down that. Does that make sense? So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to learn something called binary line following. It's just a name that I came up with. Binary means that there's one of two possibilities. It's either a black line or it's not a black line. So, and then the robot is going to wiggle its way down the black line. And then after that, we're going to learn a more complicated way of following a line called proportional line following. And both of those methods are going to be very useful for when you need your robot to follow a line. So let's have a look. First thing we want to do is go create a new project. Let's call it CA Python line following. Hit the Python icon and then click create. Okay. We can hide the helper for now. And then let's connect our robot. The Bluetooth button. Bluetooth. Good. All right. So we've defined a hub, but now We're going to define our movement motors equals motor pair C and D. And we also need our color sensor. So color sensor equals color sensor at B. Okay. So after we've defined everything, this is where we're going to execute our code. So here we're going to try binary line following first. Binary line following. So we have a forever loop, so while true. Oops, while true. And then we have an if-else statement. If the color sensor dot get color is equal to black, then we steer towards the left. So we're going to go use our tank block. So movement motors dot start tank. Why am I not using move tank? Because we don't know exactly when to stop, right? We're just going to start the motor and we're not defining how much we're moving. Start tank 0, 20. So the left motor's 0, right motor's 20. That way it's steering towards the left. Else, boom motors.start tank 20, 0. So if it's not black anymore, if my sensor has gone off the black line, then we steer back towards the black line. Okay. All right. Let's test it out. There we go. So you make sure you start with the sensor on the black line first, and then it's going to wiggle along. Very cool. See you one more time. See? So it's wiggling along the black line. Okay. But now you see how the robot is a bit jerky when it moves along the black line. That's because for our tank move, we are stopping one of the motors each time we're moving. And that's why it does this little jerky movement. If we wanted to make it smoother, then instead of making one of the motors stop, then all we have to do is make it so that it's slower than the fast motor. So let's change it to 10, see how that looks. So here, change it to 10. This one, we'll change it to 10 as well. And let's check it out, see if it makes a difference. See, much better. But why would we not want to just raise the speed all the time? Why don't we just have it really, really far up? Well, the weakness of binary line following is that if the line's angle changes, because the line's not always straight, right? The line might be a squiggly line. If it's too bendy, then if you're going too smoothly forward, then it's not going to steer in time to follow the line. So that is the weakness of binary line following. But this is the kind of method that that you learn in EV3 in the core set lessons, right? So we are going to try and solve that by using something called proportional line following. What does proportional line following do? Proportional line following is where the robot detects how far off the black line it is. And then if it's really far off, then it steers some more. If it's not very far off, then it steers less. And that makes it so that the movement is much smoother and a little bit more efficient as well. So let's have a look at proportional line following. So in order to understand proportional line following, let's have a look at the motor port view up here on the top left. You see how we have sensor B, and then we have three motors, right? C, D, and E. On sensor B, I have the sensor over the top of the black line right now, and it shows that it is black. See, it's saying showing black. If I move it away from the black line, it shows that it's white. Right? If you have a different color table, if you have a red color table, it might show red. It might show no color, right? What we want to show is that it's either black or white on my table, but on your table it might show it's black and something else, all right? As long as you're using a black line. This is good for binary line following because if it's black it does one thing, if it's not black it does something else. But it's not good for proportional line following. For proportional line following, we need a different motor mode, sorry, sensor mode, and that is reflected light intensity. So we're going to detect how much blackness there is under the robot. So in order to do that, let's click on your hub connections. And then where it's got your color sensor, you see how it's detecting colors at the moment. We're changing it to reflections to reflect reflected light intensity. Now it's showing 10% instead of a color. So if it's at 0%, that means there's no light reflected, and at 100% means that all the light's been reflected. So, zero for, I mean, sorry, for me, on black, it is showing 10%. On white, it is showing around about 90%. All right. So you have to work out the average between those two readings. Okay. So for me, the average between 10 and 90 is 50. All right, and then you have to note that down. So first of all, we comment out the binary line following. Now we're going to do proportional line following. And the average reading between my black value, which is 10, and my white value, which is about 90, is about 50. So at 50, my robot steer value should be zero. So at 50% reflected light intensity, we need to be going straight because we don't want to be steering at all if we're right on 50%. But we steer away from if we are at 10% or if we're at 90%. Okay, so let's do the code. So here we go, while true. Instead of having an if-else statement, we just have one statement now. It's just movement motors dot start. But instead of having open and close brackets like we had before in the first lesson, the value inside start actually defaults to zero, which is a straight move. So all we have to do is change it to be a steer value based on our color sensor reading. So color sensor dot get underscore reflected underscore light minus 50. So this number, 50 for me, is that average value between 10 and 90. But for you, make sure you work it out what it is for you before you put that number in, okay? And then also we want to make it so that our movement motors are slower. So set default speed to 20. And this is going to make a very smooth line following action. Let's have a look at that. Oops. So start with your black line on the sensor. See? See how it found the line really quickly, and it's very efficient when it follows this line. See? Let's have a look at it on a larger map. So you can see that there was an error there because the line had a very gentle turn at the start, but then at the opposite ends of the oval, they're very sharp turns. So the robot didn't turn sharp enough to follow the line. And that's where we have to add something called a multiplier to fix it. A multiplier will make it so that if there is a sharp turn, then our robot will adjust and adapt to the line more quickly. By having a high multiplier, it may make us follow the line better, but it may also make it so that it's not as straight. But I'll show you how to do that now. So here is our spike prime code. So all we have to do to add a multiplier is everything inside motor start, we put a bracket around it, and then multiply everything by 2. Okay. This makes it so that the steer value is doubled when it is off that center point. And that's going to make us more responsive. If it's still understeers, then you keep increasing this number. But 2 should be enough for us on a gentle oval, like what we tested before. Let's have a look at it now. That's it from us for this lesson. If you like this video, then please like and subscribe to my channel. Next lesson, we're going to talk about functions, and I can't wait. I'll see you next time. Bye-bye.